Hello and welcome to Points of Interest. I'm Jake, along with my co-host James over here.
Hi, guys.
If you're new to the show, each week we come to you with stories and discussion about topics around the internet. Woo! Sort of, in a very small window of the internet.
Whatever so internet really, we're interested in.
That's the sphere of interest of inverted reality.
Right.
You can get this on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, VidMe.
It's on TuneIn. So this is weird. So I couldn't find us as a podcast on TuneIn, but you can search Points of Interest, and it'll show you in there
a few points of interest,
points of interest. But you search it, and we're half the results that come up. So that's cool. I don't know why they won't just have us as a podcast. So TuneIn can just eat it for all I care. I have done as much work as I'm going to do with it.
TuneIn, you've made this too difficult. Anyways, make sure you follow us on Twitter at IRGames.
Yep.
Stay up to date on what we're doing. Our personal Twitter is just rolled across the bottom of the screen.
Yep. I saw it.
And they'll be in the description for those of you listening to the audio podcast.
Yes.
I look at the camera so much, I think it's oh, it's just a video podcast. People are watching it, so the screen is all the prompts they'll ever need.
But always.
There's a large portion of our audience that listens to the audio.
Right, exactly.
Actually.
Which
How
is
you been,
great.
James?
You know, I'm good.
I feel like I haven't seen you for 24 hours.
You know, it's been an interesting week. So it's not as bad as last week.
So
we'll take what we can get.
No hospital trips this time.
Duffy, put that down. Thank you. I have a dog.
There's a dog over there grabbing random apparel.
Random apparel. No, I am good. It was more or less a normal back to work sort of week. So, except work sucks. So that's life.
Work is in the way of doing our true joy.
Our true joy.
YouTubing.
That's true. So today we're going to touch on a couple different things here. We got some gaming news like we normally do. We've got some miscellaneous topics we'll probably cover. And then a new thing we're doing this week, thanks to Duffin's Land, one of our loyal listeners, suggested it. And it's a great idea, but we want to start covering games that are coming out soon. So we're going to start off with a couple of games that come out in the next week or two. And then if we come across a week where there isn't anything good coming out, we'll cover something down the line. Like Prey or something down the line that I don't know about.
After watching a Let's Play in it, it does look, it looks pretty fun.
So that's some of the new things we're going to be doing with the sports season winding down for some people. We might hit some NBA news soon.
Yeah.
We're still getting kind of up to speed for both of us on that. But that's some of the stuff we're going to talk about today. If you guys have stuff you want us to talk about, you're like, man, it'd be really sweet to get IR's take on subject XYZ. Go ahead and just shoot us a message. Leave us a comment. Give us a SoundCloud.
Drop us a line.
I don't know what you do on SoundCloud, but do that. And then you can...
give us a raindrop.
That's true. Maybe do a review on iTunes, and then in your review, tell us what we can talk about, and that would work too.
Yes.
So these are all the things you can do.
Subscribe and rate us on iTunes. That would help a lot.
All that stuff.
So every rigmarole you hear in every podcast ever, just do that for us as well.
Yeah, it works.
Just assume... Dog? He's as under my feet as he could possibly be.
Sure, well, he's...
There we go.
He's going to curl up soon and just plop down.
If he could curl up in the middle of under the table instead of under my feet under the table, that'd be perfect.
He's at my feet. He likes to curl up right next to me.
We have noticed that yesterday.
A mini dachshund. He's 4 months old. I have one with my wife.
One.
He doesn't.
I do not have one.
So
I play with one.
He's pretty awesome, but he's a handful. So.
Literally.
What are... All right, so what are we starting with today, Jake?
We're going to start with Nintendo Switch digital game file sizes have been revealed. Found this article on GameSpot, where I find a lot of my articles, because it's bookmarked on my internet browser.
We'll expand later, don't worry.
Exactly, yeah, we'll get there as sources roll. When sources start approaching us, # snobbery, # nose in the air. But game size has been revealed. And they're not awful, but you're going to get into a dance of storage if you don't buy... external storage right away, especially if you want Dragon Quest Heroes 1 and 2, because the Switch ships with internal memory of 32 gigabytes.
Mm-hmm.
And if you know how memory works inside of a system, you don't get all 32 of those gigabytes. You might get 27.
That's what I would guess.
27 of those gigabytes. Dragon Quest Heroes 1 and 2 is going to take up 32 gigabytes on its own.
It's a launch title, right?
That is a launch title. So you will be buying a memory card with your Switch if you want to play Dragon Quest Heroes at launch.
That's what it says. It literally is. That's just ridiculous. It's stupid.
I mean, honestly, when I buy a Switch, I'm going to be looking at getting an internal memory, getting
another
an SD card anyways, because I just want that. Because, excuse me, I have a Vita, and I don't have a big memory card for it. I have an 8 gig memory card because they are so expensive.
Yeah. At least this isn't...
This isn't proprietary memory, so they have that going for them, but it's just still, 32 gigs for this normal game. And if you get the rest of the launch titles, at least most of them, Legend of Zelda, Mario Kart, Puyo Puyo, Tetris, that game, what is that?
Disgaea
5? Mm-hmm. Disgaea 5. That's how it's pronounced, actually. That's Disgaea 5. I've heard it before.
Okay.
Snipperclips, I'm Setsuna, and Nobunaga's Ambition.
Yeah.
Those all together are 36 and a half gigs, roughly.
Mm-hmm.
So you should get a gig. You should get a memory card anyways, if you intend on gaming on the Switch for multiple games.
Like, yeah. So the one, there's a couple of those that aren't launch titles as we're reading the article, but you know, Mario 8's going to come out here in a couple months, and a couple of those are there. They currently have 10 launch titles. We've talked about those before.
I thought Mario Kart was a
Not quite.
Launch title.
That's the big problem. Like, I would probably get it sooner if Mario Kart was a launch title. No, that's later, later in the year.
Oh. But so, you're waiting for Mario.
I'm also waiting for Mario Odyssey.
Odyssey. I was like, there's a Mario.
That's a
Mario
big kicker, but like Mario Kart, I haven't got to play it in a while. I didn't play 8 because we didn't have the Wii U. But it's still ridiculous. Like, we're talking 4 or 5 games that are going to fill up your hard drive, right? Your memory card. And so this was the problem that we had talked about. A lot of people have talked about. And it's like literally like if you buy more than 2 games on launch, like, just get an SD card too. Like, that's
exactly.
It's, I get that it's really nice and you don't have to have proprietary stuff, and that's great and wonderful. But we're out of space.
I know. And like, I don't know Jack Diddley about Dragon Quest Heroes. Like, I don't know how big the games are, but Legend of Zelda weighs in at 13 and a half gigs.
Yeah.
And you tell me these two games are 15 gigs apiece?
Right.
Like, are they really bigger than Breath of the Wild?
I mean, from what I know, they're, you know, they're JRPGs.
Yeah.
Big,
but usually
universe
that's like,
type games.
That's pretty much text, right? Unless you're,
yeah, that's true.
When I think JRPG, like, obviously there's Final Fantasy is a big one, but I play Persona,
mm-hmm.
and that is just a step away from a visual novel. Like,
right.
That's all it is. Or interactive novel.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just kind of like, well. Like,
yeah. It's interesting. I'm not necessarily interested in those specific games, so that's not a big deal. But, you know, for people that buy Nintendo, that's the kind of stuff that they like.
And they're
like,
not even, like, registered as JRPGs. Like, it's action role-playing game and hack and slash.
I mean, like, how far is that from a JRPG?
Yeah, let's but usually that here. Falls under, like, JRPG is a pretty specific.
Yeah, but they're still, like, big, like, RPGs. You know, the sources for
it's
those came from
Western
Nintendo
RPG.
Japan.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, so that's, it's one of those things where the biggest concern is the size. Like, it's great that Breath of the Wild is only 13 gigs, but let's say your console ships and before you're able to start it on anything, your memory is 26 gig, right? So you put Breath of the Wild on, that's 13 gigs. So you get what? Maybe 3 other games?
Maybe.
And
you
so
get
you're
smaller.
I know that a 500 gig hard drive on the PS4 and Xbox
How
One
big is,
were small, but we could still install 20 or 30 games before we went nuts with it and had to replace it.
I'm wondering how big 1-2 Switch is.
It can't be too big. I mean, it's.
Well, you'd think that. Is it bigger than what you're going to have left over
I mean,
from Zelda? Because
Breath of the Wild only being 13.4 gigs is actually surprising to me. I thought it would
that's
be much
exactly.
Better.
I thought it was going to be huge. Like, if they had come out and said Breath of the Wild is 32 gigs, I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. The game is giant.
Yeah, with the way they're talking about the map and things like
details.
That.
Details. But, like, I just want to find out, like, of course you don't say, thanks, Nintendo. You are so helpful. You are just the best. But, I mean,
mm-hmm.
most people are going to be buying a Switch for... Yeah. Breath of the Wild,
right?
And
first, the new Skylanders Imaginators is a launch title too. That was a recent announcement.
Yeah, but how many consoles is Skylanders going to push?
I mean, how many kids play Skylanders? Right, like Skylanders, you collect toys, you do this thing, like you go complain to your parents you haven't played Skylanders in 4 days. Now they have a new version out. It's maybe not a system seller on its own,
no,
but it's a pretty good like incentive for collectors and things like that.
Yeah, but I mean, I feel like Amiibo
more
took over
so
from
than
Skylanders,
more so than Just Dance 2017.
Yeah,
if I'm being honest.
Yeah, that's
here. So, but I mean, yeah. It's just you put on 2 or 3 games and you're full.
Yeah, and that's the dance you're going to do with the Switch now. Like, it's the same thing I do with my Vita. I have 8 gigs.
Yeah.
And so PlayStation Plus titles come out because I don't really buy a bunch of games for my Vita anymore because there's not really a ton of games out there I want.
Right.
And so it's like, all right, I want to put this game on my Vita. Okay, I don't have room. Which games do I want to get rid of? Which ones do I know I'm not going to play right now?
Yeah.
Which ones am I planning on playing later when I have a mm-hmm. chance? Like when we travel, like I want to have this game queued up because I'm going to spend 4 or 5 hours on a plane.
Yeah.
That gives me dedicated time with my Vita that I can play this game.
That's true.
I don't have that right now. And I don't really want to play it in 10-minute chunks.
Yeah, no, that's fair. And so, but I mean, it's, are we going to get to the point where in 6 months they're going to have a bundle that includes an SD card? Or like have a special edition Nintendo Switch that comes with 64 gig of memory?
That'd be very un-Nintendo.
Yeah, I know. Like, well, I mean, they did have, when the Wii U launched, they had the basic version that had the smaller memory and it had less stuff. And then the Pro version, which was more money and more storage.
That I can see happening. Like they remake the Switch. Like, all right, this Switch has 64 gigs of memory built in.
And like, it takes USB sticks and flying something to rainbows.
Break off the end of your tablet. Oh, I was playing my Switch and I put it down and I forgot to take the USB stick out. Now it's broken and now my Switch is broken. Nintendo won't fix it because that wasn't a pre-existing issue.
So yeah, it bothers me. Just, and it's exactly what we said it was going to be. Like it's too small. There is no conceivable reason why.
Yeah,
you
but
do that. What are you expecting from your client, your player base? Are they only going to play three games at once? Like, what's the?
I mean, you got to look at Nintendo's like player base. Like, you look at PS4 and Xbox One player base. Like, those are like core gamers. Those are the people, and PC gamers. Obviously, like, those are the people that are going out there. They are playing games 5, 6, 7 hours a day. Like, you're not sitting down at your Wii U and playing Mario Maker for 7, 8 hours a day.
But then why aren't they going after them is my question. Why not build a console that actually caters to gamers for a change?
Because two of those consoles already exist. Like, you can't step in as Nintendo, what Nintendo has been and what has, like, what they will always be, and some of them be like, we're going to compete with PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. Like, we're going to step up, we're going to beat Uncharted, we're going to beat Horizon Zero Dawn, we're going to beat Gears of War. Like, you're not.
Yeah, but
you're
not.
Nothing you can do, especially when you don't really negotiate with third parties.
But there's a line between that and, like, really selling your first parties the way they should be sold. And the problem with being a gamer is that you don't always get to play those Nintendo first party stuff because you don't want to own their console.
Yeah.
So push the first parties from a sense of a gamer, right? Give us the opportunity to be like, you know what? I want to have 8 Mario games installed on my console at once, and that's all I want to play for a week.
Yep.
But I can't do that because you gave me 32 gig of internal memory, you idiots. Like, come on.
Yeah, and like, honestly,
like, it's not hard. It's, you can't tell me that it's too expensive to do because the console's freaking $300.
Yeah.
Like, there's no way you couldn't just add. I know how much SD cards cost. I get that's a little different for you guys, but $10-$15, I'm sure people would have been happy to be like, oh, here's a $350 version that's got 128 gig of memory. Like, it's not hard. Like, it's really not. It's just sad. It just shows how out of touch Nintendo is with the gaming culture.
That's what happens
today.
When you develop your game consoles in a vacuum.
Part.
Like, yeah. It's one of those things, like, if we got more, just more Nintendo, like the Nintendo we love. Like, we sat down for 5 hours on Sunday and played Mario 3.
Yeah.
20, it was awesome.
20-year-old game.
Loved it. Like, I have a ton of Super Nintendo games, and I love them. Mm-hmm. But it's just like, this new stuff, I'm like, I don't really want to buy it. Like, I'm going to buy a Switch. I really want to play Zelda. I've missed out on several Zeldas, and I hate it. Mm-hmm. But, like, there was no reason for me to own a Wii or a Wii U. And I'm like, I'd rather own the PS4 and invest into that.
Yeah.
And it's just like, okay, like, in, like you said, like, we're gonna have to delete games, which for us is not a problem. Like, we have good internet.
Yeah.
Like, deleting a game and downloading a game, okay, that's an hour, maybe 2 hours of our time that we lose that we could have been gaming. We have other stuff to do. But there's people out there that they spend their days downloading a game to play. And it's just like,
yeah, it's not something that should be an issue anymore. I just don't understand it.
No.
Like, it just,
Nintendo is still just like, just that out of touch. Like, no third party. Okay, launch lineup and bad internal memory. Boy, they better knock it out of the freaking park with their online shop.
It better work like they say it's going to, right? Like, it needs the battery life.
I've seen,
and like, not having a performance hit when you take it
reviewers are like, have consoles in hand. I was watching Kind of Funny Morning Show yesterday. Mm-hmm. They had a Switch on the table. Like, they couldn't open it yet. They couldn't open it on camera because, embargoes
and stuff.
But they're playing it, and we'll find out soon. So
yeah, for sure.
Yeah, we'll find
out.
Oh,
it's ridiculous.
But anyways.
Still, I'm annoyed by it.
Excited, but disappointed at the same time.
Yeah, it's just...
Life of a Nintendo gamer.
It is not off to a great start for
their
launch. Maybe it'll launch, and the games will be great, and we'll finally get good reviews from Nintendo, and they'll start pouring out good title after good title. But
if you do want a pretty good in-depth, like, from the industry cap on the things Nintendo's doing wrong, if you go to just look up on YouTube, Colin was right, Nintendo Switch. Like, honestly, like, I know, like, I harp on Kind of Funny a lot, but like, this is legitimately great information. Like, he just presents it in a really good 10-12 minute video of here's what is happening with the Switch, and just It's pretty good.
Oh, it's good stuff. I appreciate it for sure.
All right, moving on.
Moving on
into the section where we're out of gaming news at this point
because there wasn't a lot this week.
Just not a ton. I mean, there probably was, but
I didn't
dig that hard. yes, I'm. Never get that connection like way too late on your computer that something's disconnected. Like I left work at 5:30. It's 10:30 now, and I just got this notification on my computer. It says I'm disconnected from my servers at work. Thanks, computer.
Nice. Good job, man.
Anyways, Ghost Recon Wildlands has an open beta that starts today as this video comes out.
Yes.
Because this video comes out tomorrow for us.
Tomorrow. But so as of this moment, the beta's live.
February 23rd. It starts at 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Yep. It goes to
rolls through the 27th.
Yeah.
I'd imagine till 11:59.
Yeah, it's interesting because, you know, after the wonderful success of Division, sarcasm, it's a similar, I mean, Division improved, but it was one of those too little too late things and still needing to have the season pass to get a lot of the cool stuff.
Yeah.
But with Ghost Recon Wildlands, it was similar to, I think, what they were going for in Division, but in an environment that makes more sense. It's like taking the Division and putting it not in a futuristic end of the world setting, it's Ghost Recon, which everybody loves, everybody knows.
I think it's going to take more strategy. Like the Division, you could pretty much just go in, wait for enemies to show up, and start shooting. Division was a third person shooter.
It was a very basic, formulaic way to do it. Is you go in, you have, you get out your bullet hose and you throw everything at this guy until he dies, and you just repeat the waves, and that was the whole game. And there was no depth to it, and I enjoyed it. Until you got to the end and there's nothing to do.
I hear they've updated it and there's more stuff to do, but it's kind of too late at this point.
Well, a lot of the stuff they updated, like that has moved on. A lot of the stuff they updated for the Division, like you had to have the season pass for, like stuff that came in the DLC with it, which sounded like some really cool stuff. Like, I never got to play it and I didn't really want to get the season pass for somebody that was just so terribly developed.
It was a fun experience for whatever, 15-20 hours.
Yeah.
Like, and
I like the interacting with the environment. Anyways, so
moving on to Ghost Recon. Ghost Recon has different elements from Division in the sense of you can play either stealthy or kind of run and gun, but it affects the world around you.
Yeah.
So like you're in this fictional country that's kind of based on Bolivia, and you can run in and take down people, but that affects the missions down the road, how you do it. So you do have to be strategic in what missions you do stealthy and what missions you do loudly. And I think that's kind of a cool mechanic. Like it kind of harkens back a little bit to the, we were talking about Shadow of Mordor the other day and like how cool that was to see the system of this captain beat you. And so now he's moved up in the power ranks and you got to work a little harder to get to him. Like this kind of seems like that same thing, a little bit of a different spin on it of what you do affects the world around you and more than just this one guy or this one mission.
No, it's super interesting. It depends on execution. Like how really different is it going to be? Is it going to be like in open world games where it's like, oh no, this guy died instead of this guy dying? Or like, does it make this mission later on, you can't do it stealth because you didn't do it stealth before? Like what's the, deep does it go down the rabbit hole? The way that it was done in Shadow of Mordor, I realized different developer and publisher and all that, but was really extremely well done with their Nemesis system.
Just reading through this article on GamesRadar, as always, we'll put the links to articles we use in the description below. If they're not there, hang on. I tried to do it last week on SoundCloud and the website was down. Like I kept popping up, but it's just like, bing, you can't log in right now. I'm like, why? You can't log in right now. Thanks.
But I want to.
Yeah, but this says, quote, for example, you'll be able to side with local rebels to help out in battles against more powerful factions within Santa Blanca cartel. Or you can try and instigate infighting within the cartel itself by manipulating information. Or you can create distractions in one place to help you sneak in and complete primary objectives with greater ease. Kind of end quote there. And that's the effect it has on the game. So, like, you pick who you want to use. And I'd imagine, like, if you side with the rebels, like, they're kind of on your side now. If not, they really have no effect on the game. Or if you do something to kind of create, like, a rub against you and the rebels, like, then there's no point in trying. So that's the kind of thing that I'm interested to see how it works out. So you just got to be careful of when you want to be stealthy, when you want to create distractions, and when you want to side with locals on what you want stuff to do.
It's interesting. And they talk a little bit. They released like a 20-minute video of some of the single-player gameplay. And it's interesting because you still have AI. Like, the whole thing's built around having a squad. That's always been Ghost Recon's thing, right? That's been a Tom Clancy thing. It's
been a huge turnoff for me for Ghost Recon. I never really wanted to manage a squad. I'm like, they need to manage themselves. Like, I don't want to tell you what to do. Just
do what I do, but 2 seconds later. Like, that's it.
Just stay behind me and just do what I do. Copy and paste. You crouch. If I'm being quiet, you be quiet.
But it is interesting because I think all these multiplayer games are trying to, they're trying to pursue that real world, like, battle feel to it, right? Like, having those guys and you're on your chat, right, with your friends, and you're hanging out and you're actually giving orders, right? It's not just like in the cheesy trailers that they do at E3, right? It's you actually doing this and being like, hey, I need you, player number three, to go up the hill, see if you can see like a better way in, or like, hey, I need you to go take a sniper position, or Jake, I need you to cause a distraction so I can cause another distraction, or like, let's all pull out our machine guns, just go ham, right, destroy everything,
go get the car and be ready because we're about to come out and just womp.
Like I'd love the concept of that. It's just, it's never really been executed as well as it could be.
Yeah, from what I've heard from people that have played it, they're like, yeah, like, you see the trailers and they're like, oh, that's cheesy, nobody does that. And we get in there and at first we're kind of goofing off and doing our thing, but then as we get into it, like, it's more like that than you think it'd be. And obviously we haven't played it, and hopefully we'll get a chance to this weekend and maybe get on with some of our regular team and play a little bit. But they're like, it's legit, like, hey, you need to go up around here and do this, like, this is happening, like, take it down and hold on, wait, like, shoot now and all this stuff, like, you're playing legit strategy and everything. You read is, if you're going to be online, be ready to communicate because you're going to have to.
I mean, it's a lot like Rainbow Six Siege. Rainbow Six Siege, it's a very much a, like, a multiplayer shallow-ish kind of game, right? Yeah. It's very specific kind of modes,
story running around,
very specific scenes. Like, they have single player things to do, but there's no story with it. And but that's another one of those where they said, like, oh yeah, you're gonna have to communicate with your team, and everyone's like, no, that's not actually gonna happen. And it's like, no, actually, it really does happen.
If you don't communicate with them, you might as well not play.
Yeah, it's really cool the way that it's done, and that sort of thing. It works really well. And Rainbow Six games have always been, like, squad based. You know, even back to Rainbow Six. You know, it's I remember, like, doing those. You'd go and do, like, the terrorist hunts, right? And they'd throw 50 terrorists in a building, and you'd jump up with your squad, and you'd go through and you'd yell out orders and call out where you're at in the building. And it's just been a thing for Rainbow Six. And so I know that Ghost Recon's slightly different. It's, you know, a little bit more their futuristic stuff, a little bit more technical than, like, Rainbow Six kind of things were.
Yeah, Ghost Recon's always been a little bit more, like, on the stealthy, you have to do this in a certain way sort of thing. Like, Rainbow Six, you can kind of go in from different ways. Like, Ghost Recon's kind of like, this is how you kind of got to do it.
Yeah, and that's what's always been a turnoff for me. As you know, I'm not a big stealth guy. I don't understand it. I don't know how to do it. It's not my style. Like, when I play Diablo 3, I play as a barbarian because I don't want to be far away from people. I want to hit people with my axe. Like, if I ever played Overwatch, I'd probably pick a character that was in everybody's face with a shotgun, right? Like, that's just what I do. That's my...
You're much a tank kind of character.
I'm a tank. Like, that's perfect to describe everything that I play as. So Ghost Recon has never appealed to me because they don't suit tank players. And that's... now that we're seeing this, and I'm still hesitant because it's hard to be a tank in a game where you can die with three bullets, right? It's a difficult concept to pull off. That's kind of why I like The Division, because I could be a tank, right? I could just go right up there in somebody's faces and we could have a sniper picking somebody off. And it was great and it was awesome. And that aspect of it was really good. And if we can bring that in somehow, but, you know, you still have the vulnerability of being a real person getting shot at. So it'll be really interesting. We're definitely going to play the beta.
Yeah, I think it works well for people like us, where we do have a group of guys that we've played with for a couple of years now.
Yeah,
that we can hop in and be like, yo, you guys want to run some stuff in Ghost Recon? Like, it's probably not in a daily player.
Right.
But we can just be like, hey, want to hang out with some guys and let's play some Ghost Recon. Like, we have guys that fit our play style
like,
well.
Communicate.
Yeah. Exactly. Like, they fit our play style well. Like, we have you who is a tank and a couple guys who are, like, mid-range and another guy that can be long-range, and it just works really well. And I think that'll be fun to hop online with those guys again because we've been so busy and not been able to play the games that they play. So
I like that they're supposed to be, they haven't really said a ton about it. I'm sure there's some videos out there on it, but like the character customization is supposed to be pretty deep, right? It's not just like pick a face and pick a bandana and this is your guy and he wears the same camo as everybody else, right? I always like customization options. I realize it's kind of silly, but for an open world game, I feel like that's necessary. Ghost Recon hasn't really done open world before. I think that's something
that some people are glossing over. About it,
You know, I mean, the last open world game didn't go so great for Tom Clancy's, you know, generation of stuff. But I think it's going to be interesting because it's one thing to just go in and do missions as infiltrating a cartel, but are you going to be infiltrating it and like hanging out with this cartel just like in your open world? And maybe you do missions for the cartel. Like, I don't know. Like, what does that look like for side missions? Yeah. Like, side mission for this cartel, go kill this other drug dealer. And it's like, okay, I guess I will.
Maybe that's
like,
part of what affects the open world.
You know, so it's interesting. Like, oh, you killed 75 rebels. You can't use rebels anymore. Sorry, you can only kill 70. Like, well, be interesting. So, maybe we're wildly off base, but I doubt
it. So it releases on March 7th. PS4, PC, Xbox One.
Nintendo Switch?
Huh? No, because you can't voice chat.
Ah, that's
kind of a big deal.
That's why.
Definitely weren't able to do that on the original Rainbow Six 10 years ago.
Be ridiculous.
That's awkward.
No, there's a sweet app on your phone for it.
Yeah, it's called the phone. But $60 standard edition, $70 deluxe edition, $100 for the gold edition. No idea what you get in the deluxe.
I'm going to assume the gold is probably like a season pass.
There might be. I don't know. Deluxe is probably like. I probably should have. You know what? We're here. This is a casual podcast.
I would assume gold is probably like comes with a season pass and like a shiny butt metal and some other fun.
I imagine the deluxe edition is probably a season pass.
I don't know if deluxe is only $10 more though. That's not much for a season pass. I mean, normally like $30-$40.
Ghost
maybe they don't have a season pass. Maybe they're just
gold edition.
I mean, I doubt it, but
let's look up here. Everybody talk to yourselves.
I love in the review article that
bonus,
we have. I love that in the review article we have here, it actually says TLDR, be ready to get very, very social. So it's good that they read Reddit as well.
I know, right? I saw that.
I used that in an email once at work.
Really?
Yeah, I did. And I just like it. That was like right after I got into Reddit. And so like you saw that in every article, like everything you read, there was this big long piece. TLDR was at the end of it. And so I would, I put that at the end of one of my super long emails to summarize it. Cause I know people don't read those long emails. And then like somebody like IM'd me right after. He was like, oh, bro, do you Reddit?
All right, deluxe pack includes base game plus an exclusive weapon, gear, and other premium content.
Okay, so it's crap.
Gold edition.
It's a steelbook.
Base game, deluxe pack.
Ooh.
Season pass subscription giving you access to two major expansions. So
it's the Division.
Deluxe edition is basically worthless, and gold edition gives you season pass.
That's true.
So don't waste $10, but you might think about wasting 40.
Yeah.
So
if you're going to put... it's so hard. It's so hard to like endorse season passes and things like that.
Here's the deal. Like pre-order of all this crap. Like I pre-ordered Horizon Zero Dawn because I know I'm going to buy that game because I've heard enough good things about it that I know it's going to be great because I've seen reviewers and reviews.
Damn, I get a louder freaking chair.
I know I can't hear myself. but like I know it's going to be great because everything is, you know, it's getting nines and tens everywhere.
Right.
Haven't heard a dang thing about Wildlands. Not going to pre-order it.
Well,
won't pre-order Season Pass until it gets here. Like, it's not. That's
to be fair, Ghost Recon Wildlands didn't come out for like another week after Horizon Zero Dawn.
Yeah,
so the embargo probably hasn't dropped yet.
Yeah, but like Horizon was pretty hyped before
it was.
But like, it's part
of that. It's not Ubisoft, so.
Yeah, it's you know part of that, like,
it's
if you don't know, don't pre-order.
Yeah.
Like, the benefits of pre-ordering?
That's what I love about Horizon.
Like,
is
minimal
that
at best.
They decided not to do any pre-order bonuses. It's like, that's great, because I can choose to pre-order it. I'm going to. I did, because they dropped the review embargo 8 days early, which is unheard of. You're lucky if anyone drops reviews more than a day before their title.
Yeah.
Full 8 days early, we were seeing stuff about it. We're seeing, you know, numbers on playthroughs of like 40 or 50 hours for platinum trophy. There's one skippable trophy. They said they wouldn't talk about it, but they implied it. It's kind of like a story spoiler type thing, but you can get it on one really detailed playthrough. You know, you don't have to do like a second playthrough. You know, like it's like coming up time after time. Like, this is the one to do.
And just to make sure we are clear, there is a pre-order bonus for Horizon Zero Dawn.
Ooh, what is it?
But it is a machine trapper pack, a resource pack that includes modifications for your weapon, outfit, and resources for crafting ammo and traps.
Huh. Well, I stand corrected.
And an outfit and a bow. So you get a weapon, a mod pack, and an outfit. So nothing huge. Didn't pre-order it for those reasons. I pre-ordered it because I know it's going to be great.
Was that pre-order bonus for all retailers? Or just like
I think so.
It's weird.
I'm not sure. Well,
I haven't seen anything about that.
I ordered it on Amazon, and it said, this is eligible for a pre-order bonus, and you'll get that email eventually. So
weird.
If you're unsure, like you gain nothing for pre-ordering, and you lose nothing for not. So wait. If it comes out and it's great, cool. Buy it.
That's,
and
well,
if
see,
it
comes out nice
and it's terrible, Sweet, you saved money.
Yeah, the big reason that we like to pre-order, at least get it right around release date, is because we've got Amazon Prime.
We also make content.
20% off, and we make content. But 20% off, so that helps, because it's like, if you take a new game, you want to play it, you feel good about it. How long is it going to be until that game is, say, $50, right? That's 20% off plus tax. It's going to be a month or two, right? At least.
At least.
And so...
You could be looking at 3 to 6 months.
Yeah, you could be looking at 3 or 4 months for a big AAA title.
You could be looking at years.
Yeah. And so... If you know that you're already going to get it cheaper than a new game,
yeah,
it's much easier. With Amazon, they do it within the first 2 weeks of the launch and then the pre-orders. And then for Best Buy Gamers Colon Lock, which I also have, it's anytime, like any game, 20% off, which is really cool. It's a really good way to do it because chances are, like, Best Buy's prices aren't great. 20% off of them, all of a sudden it's better than everybody else. Now I can just walk down to the store and buy it. It's a little ringing endorsement for that.
Little pre-order advice from the Inverted Reality crew.
Once you know that there is or is not pre-order bonuses. Actually, really thought that podcast they like had bonus pushed for it.
Listening to our...
If you guys pre-order the podcast.
Pre-order our podcast, which maybe someday will work out.
So, I want to talk about Horizon Zero Dawn. I am so excited. Man,
dude,
I'm so excited it
almost hurts.
Oh, it's so amazing. I've never... it's been a long time since I pre-ordered a game, like a week and a half in advance, but...
It's been a long time since I pre-ordered a game that I was so dang excited about. I think the last game I pre-ordered was... I don't know. We didn't really pre-order Call of Duty.
We did Destiny stuff.
Destiny, like, that was exciting. I still wasn't this excited about that. Like, I mean, we were pretty excited. We woke up at 1 in the morning to play new Destiny expansions. Really but, good. Like,
I mean, outside of Destiny,
like, No Man's Sky, and that was, I mean, we all know how that turned out. But I haven't been this excited for a pre-ordered game in a long time.
Well, we were, you know, the last one I can think of is Battlefront. We were super excited for that.
That was pretty awesome.
And it was wildly underwhelming.
Yeah, I mean, it was the first time we'd actually gone out and stood in line for a midnight release.
Since
college. Yeah. When we bought Black Ops. And we went and stood in line and hung out with some guys and had some awkward conversations with people that didn't go that much. And then
people driving, they were driving like one of those BB-8 drones. Because it was right before
Force Awakens.
And it was just, it was a dearth of content.
Yeah.
Right? Is that the right word? Not very much.
I thought dearth was a lot.
It was lacking. It was lacking in content.
It was a fun 5 or 10 hours, and then
it went downhill real quick.
I mean, it was a fun, like, casual third person shooter.
Yeah. Hey, dearth does officially mean a scarcity or lack of something. There we go. So I win.
But yeah, like, there was a small part of me that if I wanted to burn a day off, thought about, like, what if I take a day off to play Horizon? Problem is, like, it comes on a Tuesday. Tuesday is a pretty important meeting day for me.
Yeah.
So
if I hadn't just taken a week off of work for medical stuff, I would have already scheduled a day off for this.
Yeah.
But I'm technically out of PTO for like another 2 weeks.
But yeah, it's one of those things that I know, like, I'll spend as much free time as I have at home playing this game. And
yeah,
I know. Like,
I'm just hoping my fingers are crossed personally, because we have it on Amazon, that it'll be one of the times where the Amazon pre-order gets there like a day or two early, because I've seen that happen before.
Boy, that'd be nice.
Boy, that'd just be the best surprise ever, wouldn't it? Just, these are the things that I think about.
So the trick with us now is, like, making content like we do, like, yes, it'd be great to get on this Horizon train, but, like, that means we'd play the game twice.
Like, right in a row.
I'm not going to not play it at home just to play it once a week on Tuesday night for a couple hours.
It's killing me. And Final Fantasy has been really tough for me in that regard, because we've been just doing just streams of that.
Yeah.
And then I'm so much farther in the IR account than I am on my own account. I'm like, well, I mean, I'd have to play 4 hours just to catch up and do all the things I've already done. It's daunting, because the story is good, but it's not like... worth it to do that. Yeah. You know what I mean? So I don't want to do that with Horizon. I think the nice thing about it is the open world concept. An RPG, it's much more of an RPG than I think I realized when you started seeing the trailers and you started seeing stuff come out. Kind of funny games. Colin.
Greg did a Let's Play.
I didn't watch all of it because I don't want to spoil too much. We've been trying to stay away from
it. I've been pretty radio silent on this. Like, I've seen the E3 trailer. And I've seen part of a game trailer, and I watched the beginning bits of Kinda Funny's, like, Greg and Colin's review on it.
Yeah.
And, like, that's all I've watched.
And then you just, like read stuff.
I've seen, like, article titles. Like, the one that grabbed me the most, said, Horizon is a world that is begging for you to explore every corner of the map. Like,
I like it.
That just sounds exciting. Like, because there's open world games out there, like Far Cry. I played a lot of Far Cry 4. And it was fun, and I loved exploring because you go out and you, you know, get animals and upgrade your stuff and take down, like, base camps, stuff like that. Like, but at a certain point, you're like, I know what that is. I know what that's going to be.
Yeah.
So it'll be really cool to get into a game that's like, hey, you should if really go check this out.
That's my concern.
Yeah.
It's my concern with all open world games, and I think it's really hard to not do that, right? It's a, who made Horizon? I'm blanking on this.
Guerrilla
Games did it. So they've never done an open world. So it's like, is it going to be like an Assassin's Creed style where you take over points and it captures parts of the town
really
and
then like
unlocks,
it.
You know, key points of interest and things like that? Or is it going to be more of a Witcher 3? is it going to be more of like a Witcher 3 style thing? And so I was reading a lot about it. But I'm really excited. You know, it's, I typically don't like line up in opinions with Colin on RPGs and stuff like that. I'm not a big RPG guy.
Yeah.
But there's just something about like the visuals for this and the gameplay. I watched a 2-minute video the other day on trying to take down like a Thunderjaw or something. And it was unbelievable. And she died. And it was just, it's unbelievable like the amount of options you have at your disposal. And some people, I saw one person comment and they were like, oh my goodness, the whole game just going to be using a bow and arrow. Like,
you're using a bow and arrow to take down robotic dinosaurs.
Like, I just...
Let's just think about that for a second before you inflict your stupidity on the rest of us.
It's ridiculous.
If you don't have anything funny to say, don't say anything.
It's insane. So it's... it just... It looks...
We get that printed on a shirt somewhere.
Maybe. It just... It looks impressive. You know, everyone says it looks really good. A lot of people have been saying it's the best exclusive yet for PS4.
And well, that's crazy. Like,
that's like saying Uncharted 4.
Said that.
Yeah.
Like, those guys love Uncharted and love Naughty Dog and are very invested in the PlayStation universe, and they're like, this is the best exclusive for PlayStation 4.
It's insane.
Knowing that, like,
it's
we have a pretty
really
good exclusive
hard,
list, but it's just like Uncharted 4 was one of the best games that has come out for consoles, period.
Yeah.
And then they're like, Horizon is better. I was like, that's amazing.
I mean, the only thing I could see of Horizon being better would be being able to put more time into it. With Uncharted, you could play it through a couple times, but really,
I don't really want to play it twice.
I just it was such a good story. The story was unbelievable in Uncharted 4. I hope that it's similar here. I really want Guerrilla Games to have a hit that's not Killzone. Like, Killzone is good. Killzone has its niche and it does it really well. It's the fidelity is really great. It has the right kind of weight, I feel like, to the guns. Killzone's great, but it's always just been missing something that doesn't like get
it's
you
like public grab. Like, it never, like, really explodes out there and is, like...
Well, the problem
I mean,
is
granted, it's got to put up with... It's got to compete with Call of Duty and Battlefield and all these other, like,
it's always
struggled,
but it was
games,
it was a launch title. Shadowfall was a launch title for PS4, and I played it. That game was gorgeous, right? The story just... I wasn't interested, and I found myself halfway through. I had no idea what was going on anymore.
I played Killzone...
I just... It didn't grab me. You played...
Was it 3?
You would have played 3.
I played 3. Was it, and the story was just, like, eh. Like, the voice acting was good, but the script was bad.
It was bad.
It's just like, oh, wow. How about that for a fun cliche that we're playing this time? Well, look, it was like one cliche to the next. And I'm like, oh, that's just...
Yeah. And so Shadowfall was better, but it just didn't grab you. And it was just, it's like one of those games that's just like one step away from being a huge mainstream hit, like having toys on the shelves, having like people wearing t-shirts, having these huge releases, right? And people look forward to new games for them.
Yeah.
It just was always like one step away. And so Guerrilla Games has always done really well. They're very polished games. They don't have a lot of bugs. They don't have a lot of issues. They're really well done. Their engines are gorgeous. Like, you don't have to deal with texture popping. You don't have to deal with frame rate issues. It's just really good games. And and so I really want it to succeed because I love Guerrilla Games. They're one of my favorite developers because of the Killzone series. So I'm really, really excited because all the elements that people have been talking about and describing in Horizon Zero Dawn just like jump right off the page and just scream, hey, James, come play me.
I know. I'm really excited. We're going to put so much time into it.
Yep.
And I'm just excited to get lost in another video game world.
I hope it translates well to Let's Plays and stuff like that.
If not, then I'll just have fun on my own.
That's right. You guys can suck it.
So I saw this. This is not in our notes. And I just thought it might
crap.
Be fun to discuss.
Going off the top of our
Did
heads.
Did you see this stuff about Jim Sterling?
He's one of those reviewers over at random big website.
I think he does his own stuff. I think he's just got
his own stuff.
YouTube channel, I think.
Is he the one that gave it a perfect rating, or did he...
Nope, this has actually got nothing to do with Horizon.
Oh.
I just saw it on the show today, and I thought it was funny. So there was a game developer, Digital Homicide, throw it out there, because they can eat rocks and go die, basically. They filed a $10 million case against Jim Sterling about a bad review.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
tried
yeah.
to file an $18 million case yep. against anonymous Steam reviewers for bad reviews.
Okay, I did
like,
see that.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah,
like, I thought it was like funny and sad.
I think
like,
I saw that a few days ago.
How it's, much? That's just so stupid.
It is really stupid.
I saw that. I was like, that was incredibly like a bad public move.
It just doesn't make any sense. It's, I mean, the main, and I think he came out in response to it and was like, well, I gave you that review because your game sucked, right? And yeah. It's like, just be a man.
I think they were
take the
to
fact
like,
that your game sucks and just move yeah. on with it. And they just,
I
they
think they
blamed,
were trying to say, like, he played it in a way that made it look bad or he did this and he did that.
Yeah, well, they're trying to say that because he gave it a bad review, no one else gave it a chance, and that therefore all those bad reviews on Steam are because of are his fault because
yeah.
he said it was bad. It's just stupid. It was bad. It's a really good way to blow up your own studio.
It was so bad, and so it done. Was funny like watching Colin because he was on the morning show, and he was like, "If any of you watch this, don't go. I want you to leave this show right now. Don't ever come back. Anyone that is that works for or is associated with what I call it? What was it?
Digital
homicide.
Homicide.
Like, get out." I don't want you here. And I was like, wow.
It's extreme.
Like, and it's just,
but
if,
I mean,
if this case wins, then
no way
okay.
Will.
Yeah. Oh yeah. They threw it out. Like
oh, yeah.
with prejudice. These mm. people cannot come back for this kind of thing.
Yeah.
Ever. Learned what with prejudice, without prejudice means in court cases today. Because with prejudice means they cannot come back from another angle at it
nope.
and try and get money. With if they had dismissed the case without prejudice, then
could
they could come back and be like,
angle.
Well, he did, you know, I don't know.
Well, it said A.
Psychological
was,
damage.
It said it was A. It was
developers.
B. Yeah.
Yeah. And so with prejudice, he's like, judge basically says, get out. That was really dumb. Don't ever try this again.
Don't try it. Yeah,
but if this goes
much.
Through, it's like, all right, reviewers can be sued for bad reviews now.
Yeah. I mean, that was never going to happen.
Yeah,
it
that
was
never
going to
happen.
Never going
to
be
work.
Realistic.
I just thought it was, I mean, we don't have to go any further into
it's
it because
nice
we didn't really research it, but I just thought it was.
Freedom of speech.
Yeah. I just
that's,
thought it was
funny.
Funny. Like someone gets all butt hurt, like they got a bad review because their game was bad. And they're like, you owe us $10 million because our game sucks. And we didn't make money on it.
Right, exactly. All right, so what we got? We got five 10 minutes left.
Yeah, we got a couple minutes left.
All right. I have not been writing down time, so we're going to have to go back and do these.
That's okay. I mean, close enough.
You'll see. It's fine. There'll
video
be
games for the first three quarters and not video games.
We talk about
the last
gums.
Quarter.
The gimme gum gums.
Yeah. So I just kind of got random stuff here. And this
random
kinda,
stuff.
This kind of could fall in line with what we were just talking about with the Jim Sterling thing. So
yeah.
Segue. What was your worst day ever?
Worst
that
day
you can
ever.
Remember.
Boy, that's a
like
big,
sticks out in your brain. Like, oh my goodness, like.
Question.
Ugh.
Trying to think of one that I want to tell on the internet because I got a lot of like bad days.
Yeah.
Hmm. Do you have one? Do you have one in mind?
I do have one specifically right. in mind. So I worked for a kind of corporate and production entertainment company in Kansas City for a year, and there was a group that came in. I won't say the name of the group just because it's not important. But they were doing an event, and I worked in the Kansas City Convention Center. So they were doing a big convention. They had a lot of, what we call breakout rooms. So basically separate rooms you go into for like specific classes or, you know, panels that you want to see. And then there's a convention hall upstairs where you go see like presenters or whatever. They have all their products and who's it and what's not. I really can't tell you what the event's about because I don't know. Like the whole week started off poorly.
Mm-hmm.
So basically what happens when you work in production is like the company itself doesn't necessarily do everything. We get the requests and sign the contract and we get paid and we hire kind of leads from our teams who lead teams of stagehand union people. So we call them in to work for however many hours and help us get work done. So basically what this convention was going to be 10 separate booths upstairs, a main presenting room in one of the rooms, so kind of a bigger like everyone's going to gather here to watch things,
mm-hmm.
and then 14 breakout rooms.
Oh.
So my job, because my boss was not good, was to manage all the booths upstairs and all the breakout rooms. So 24 separate entities happening in there while he managed the main room, because that was his leading capacity. So the day we were supposed to load in all the breakout rooms and the convention hall, I go upstairs to the convention hall right after all the union crew gets there, and it's not started. Like the company that lays out the carpets, because there's companies that lay out like all the carpets and the pipe and drape you see for booths, mm-hmm. like they do their job first. We work with them if we need to run cables underneath everything, and there's a separate electrical company. And we got up there and I saw tape on the floor and that was it. And I was like, we're supposed to load in today.
Right. And like, you guys can't set that stuff up.
No, we don't set that stuff up. Like that is a whole, like,
you don't
like,
even, that's not even your
two
stuff.
Convention hall. So imagine like 2 football fields long worth of space, not set up. That's not like, oh, we're going to be done by dinner. Like, no, we'll be done in 2 days.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I have all these union people here and I get downstairs. My boss isn't there yet. He's supposed to be leading the crew that's setting up breakout rooms.
Right.
And so I was like, I call him like, hey, like, where are you at? Like, union's here. Like, they're looking to me, looking for stuff to do. And I don't have a plan because this is supposed to be your thing. And he goes, oh, dude, I just woke up. I woke up late. Sorry, man. I'm going to take a shower and then I'll be in. Okay, here's the deal. He lived 30 minutes away from work. When you wake up and you're already 5 minutes late, let's get the shower.
Yeah.
Like, that is a, like, grab the nearest work shirt you have, throw on your pants, and get to work.
Yep.
Not, oh, we'll just let the guy that wasn't prepared handle it. So it started off bad. So we get to actual event time. So day before the event, I'm trying to set up all the booths upstairs, and other shows are happening. So shop equipment is just gone. And so I'm short on equipment and I'm short on stuff. And we stayed there till like 1 a.m. trying to get things set up with the union. So it's cost or like just me and the other guy. So, and so we're like calling people in the company, like, hey, are you busy? Like, I had a guy that did a show in St. Louis, was on his way back with the truck and just didn't go to the shop and came straight to the convention center and came to help me out.
Yeah.
Still didn't get it done. And it's just like the whole week they gave us communication. They gave us these little phones that they use as radios, like old Nokia style phones.
Mm-hmm.
And just like every hour that thing rang with someone like, hey, we need this in this room. I'm like, well, that's not on the contract. It wasn't ordered. But like, well, we need it. Can we get it? I'm like, maybe if I had it, I'll go check. And they're like getting mad at me and yelling at me when stuff's not right. And I accidentally screwed up a booth like upstairs. That was, and I felt so bad because they rented a 90-inch TV. Cool. TV. It was gorgeous.
That is huge.
I loved it. And they had a little sound system.
This was like, what? This is a couple years ago though, right? This wasn't like, I mean, it's TVs were even more expensive back then.
Yeah, they rented this 90-inch TV that came out in this giant road case that we rolled in the convention center and picked it up and had to mount on this ridiculous mount. And they needed speakers and stuff, and I totally missed almost everything but the TV because that was the one thing I wasn't in charge of. And it's like, that was easily the longest week of my life.
Yeah.
Like, just every day, constant, hey, this needs to happen. Hey, this didn't happen. Why didn't this happen? And we got awful reviews at the end of the whole thing. Most of which were not my fault, but some of which was.
Mainly because it got dumped in your lap and you had to...
Yeah, that was pretty much... That was most of that job kind of through that year was was my boss like taking on as little as possible and just dumping the rest on me going, hey, figure this out.
Delegation.
But
so I do have one. So I have a lot of bad days because I've had a lot of health issues, but we're going to go with a work story. So before I did IT... I worked for Dish Network, and I don't think I've told you this story. It's just I worked. There's a reason for that. Dish Network was not Dish Network itself. Great place, love the people there, love that. Just installing satellite dishes is not my thing. Like, it's just not. I can't do that. But I started in like October, right? And it was a really bad winter that year. So like, it was nasty. Like, I just didn't enjoy it.
That was you moved back to Kansas City, wasn't it?
Yeah, I moved back to Kansas City that summer, and then I that was after my internship at the church, and so it was 4 10-hour days. So I would work, I want to say it was Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Friday, Saturday. So I'd have Monday, Thursday, Sunday off. Because you can't get 2 consecutive days when you're, or 3 consecutive days when you're just starting out.
Yep.
So it was a weird schedule, but so I don't remember what day it was. It was a day that I was working. That's the important thing. So it was 10-hour shifts, so I would report at 7, and we were supposed to be done by 5. Doesn't always work. You know, sometimes you get stuck out on a job, but you're not supposed to get assigned something after 4. It's supposed to be before that in your books, so that way you know you get done. You don't put, like, an install at 4 o'clock, because install is going to take, like, 3 or 4 hours. So I had a normal morning. It was pretty nonchalant. You know, I packed my lunch, and so I would eat, like, I packed 3 sandwiches, and I eat, like, 9, I'd eat, like, 12, and then, like, 3. So I'd portion it out. I lost a lot of weight on Dish Network. That was really good about it. But so I was finishing up my afternoon snack. It was like, 2 or 3 o'clock, and they said, I was finishing up my lunch, so it was about noon, and they called me, and I was getting ready to go to my next job. And dispatch called me, which doesn't happen very often. That's always a little like, that's weird.
Something's gonna ride.
And so they called me and said, hey, look, the tech we had down south of the city called in sick today, and we got a job down there out past it's out past Miami County. Like, it was way out
that's,
there.
That's out there.
It was like a good, I want to say it was 45 minutes to an hour away from my base, right? Like, where I start it out in Lenexa.
Yep.
And so I was like, sweet, that'll be easy. I'll drive for like an hour. It'll be like, it was just adding a TV. So it's just like run a line, drop a TV box in there, we're done. Like, that's easy. That's a maybe 30-minute job, right? So I head out there. I get out there probably like 2:30. Guy's really nice, like shows me where to go. Even better part, the TV was going in the basement and it was an open ceiling. So that's super easy because I could screw it literally to anything, right? I could put it anywhere in the ceiling. He didn't care. So I just ran it along with another line and dropped it down. That was super easy. I ended up having to go out and do some work on the dish because it was a little bit misaligned. But so it's like 4 o'clock. And so I know, it's like, you know, I'm probably done for the day. Like, I should be done. It's going to take me an hour to get back. I'm going to get back at 5. We're going to be good to go. And I called in dispatch to let him know, hey, it's like, I finished my job. I'm going to head in because there was nothing left on my tablet. And he was like, hey, I've got a trouble call. It's like 20 minutes north of you. So it was on my way home.
Yeah.
They're like, this guy's just not getting his HD channels. His HD channels weren't coming in the way the dish satellites work. At least they worked like this, you know, 5-6 years ago.
Yep.
You've got, you know, your little arm right here, right? And then you've got your little receivers. And those receivers are all pointed to different latitudes in the sky for your different satellites. And so one of those is specifically at the time was for HD channels. It's like, okay, so that means it's probably just misaligned or got like knocked by the wind or something like that. So I get there and it's like a trailer, you know, just in the middle of a field. Guy was really nice. Like, he was super understanding. Like, he wasn't mad at all, which they normally are on trouble calls. He's like, I've been dealing with this for a few weeks and I thought maybe I should call somebody and just get it taken care of. He didn't really care.
Yeah.
No, he's a good guy. And so those are the kind of guys.
Shout out to that guy.
Those are the kind of guys that you want to like go the extra mile for, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm out there and I'm working on it and the dish looks right. Like, the mount is secure. And so I tried for about an hour and a half and I could get 2 of the 3 satellites, but the third one I just couldn't get, and I could not figure out why. There was some trees probably like 100 yards out, but the trees were like 200 feet tall. And so it's like, so, I mean, it could be, but it shouldn't be. But I didn't have any other. There was
grab my chainsaw.
There was nothing else. Like, I couldn't just, like, I don't know. And it was 6:30, 7 o'clock, right? And it's November, so it's dark, right? He has a light out there for me. And so it's like, man, I can't get the satellite from this spot here, right? And I tried a different end. I tried everything. I was like, nothing was working. And so I'm like, all right. And I looked out there and I saw a T-post, right? T-post was in the spot I needed it to be in. It would miss the tree. It would shoot up there. And I was like, hey, that T-post out there, you use that at all? Because we have special T-post mounts for it because that comes up quite a bit. And he's like, nah, go ahead and mount it, man. Whatever works for you. And I was like, all right, I can't bury the line tonight because, you know, it's late and you have to call. You have to call dig, and so you have to wait usually 3 or 4 days. But I was like, I can put it there, and we can mark it, and then you know it's there, and you won't mow over. He's like, I'm not mowing. It's November. And
that's a good point.
So I went, I mounted on the T-post, and I spent another 45 minutes, and I just could not get it aligned. Like, just three would not come into alignment no matter what I did. And so it's like 7:30, 8 o'clock at this point, and I am desperate. And so, like, I did a call out to all techs. Right. And just see, like, is anybody like still out there? Like, sometimes people work late, yeah, like I was. And so one of the guys that was in the area came by and he gets there like 8:30. I've been at this guy's house since like 5 and I'm exhausted. Like, I'm just done. I have no idea what to do. And he looks at the dish. He looks at the house and he looks up in the sky. He's like, why didn't you use one of the West satellites? I was like, what do you mean? He's like, yeah, didn't they teach you about the ones that you can point to the other satellite if you can't get HD? I'm like,
the satellite that just,
and so he went into my truck, right? And he was like, do you see this dish? I was like, yeah. He's like, this one's bigger than the other one, so that way it can hit a satellite farther away in the other part of the sky. So with dishes, dish network points to the southwestern part of the sky. DirecTV points to the south part of the sky. Well, you can go more west with dish network, but it's much farther away, so you got to get a bigger dish for a bigger, you know, to collect the signal a little bit better. But it's literally like we never used it because it was never a problem. Like, you could always just find a spot. So you go through it in training, but, you know, I had 2 weeks of training and there's a whole lot of stuff to cover. And I just, and so like literally took the guy 20 minutes. He put it back in the same mount on the trailer, right? And I had tried mounting it in a different place on the trailer. So there was like holes all over the guy's trailer, which he didn't care about. I had like cleared it with him first. Oh, so he went and just like screwed it back into the other one, put this other dish on, just like turned it, right? And lined up like 5 seconds. Seriously, he was in and out in 20 minutes. But I didn't leave that site until like almost 10 o'clock because of all the, like the stuff I was doing, the paperwork I was doing. So I got home because I was still like, it was a good 40 minutes back to base. And then I had to go in. I have to restock my truck when I get back, right? So make sure that all of these dishes are there. Like I have certain numbers for all the equipment that I replenished that night. So I don't have to do it in the morning. I just roll in the morning, jump in my truck and go. So I got back. I spent 20 minutes restocking my truck because I used a bunch of weird stuff that I never used that week. And so then I didn't get home until like 12:30. And I remember I worked the next day and it was just, it was awful. It was my, like, it was no bad customers. Like everybody was nice. Like I've had worse days with customers, but that was by far like the longest day of my life. I clocked in like 7 to 12 that day. It was insane. Like, because the boss, my boss had to wait for me at the, the receiving like at our base. Like he couldn't just leave with one of the techs out. And so he knew, like we'd been talking like every hour, like checking back in. So he was sitting there waiting for me when I got back in. He wasn't mad. Like I stayed until the job was done. Like he wasn't mad. He wasn't upset. Like it was fine. Dude, it is the worst. That was, I think that was the day where I was like, I can't do this forever. Like I'm not gonna, this is not gonna be a thing. I'm glad that all the medical stuff happened and I had to stop it. I have some good stories, but yeah, that one was
maybe we'll
awful.
Get to more of those later.
For sure.
But for now, that's going to wrap up our show.
Yep.
Thanks for hanging out, guys. We appreciate you just coming and watching and being part of our community. Like, we love hanging out with you guys.
Sure.
So if you like what you saw and if you're still stuck around this long, I hope you did. subscribe, comment, let us know what you want to see in the future.
Yep.
And
literally, like, if you guys tell us to do something within the realm of reason, we're probably going to do it. Like, we're really, we're really easy. We're people pleasers.
It's true.
Yeah.
We're entertainers, I think is how you could phrase that. But yeah, but we'll see you guys later.
Bye.
Bye.